how excellent is thy name.
by, Lord. Do not pass me by, Lord. I'm calling on you. Hallelujah. Out of a pure heart. Hakaroroha. Call. Yes. He'll answer. He'll answer. He is the answer. Christ is the answer to every question. Every question that you thought about. He is the answer. Christ is the answer. Out of the mouth of the Lord. So let us get ready. Stand and get ready for our pastor, Bishop Price. Hallelujah. It is my happy privilege, hallelujah, to introduce to some and introduce to all our very own Bishop James Price. Hallelujah. God bless you.
Say maybe or perhaps, he will. One thing about God, he is definite. He's absolute. He's not shaky. He's not sometimey. But he's always on time. We give honor to him who is our keeper, who is our deliverer, and most of all, he is our healer. He healed us from the sickness of sin. Brought us to where we are today. Gave us what we have so that we in turn could return some of the gifts back to him. Because it was his in the first place. It's his Holy Ghost. It's not ours. We didn't get it at Value City. We didn't get it at Burlington. But we got it directly from the source. And that is Jesus Christ. He promised us after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, ye shall have power. Power to do what? To conquer everything that Satan sends our way. If we just do it God's way, Satan can't have no way. He has to back up and surrender. But we have the ability to resist everything he brings our way. Giving honor to my wife today, to my co-worker, Minister Valerie Jackson, to our minister staff, our president, Minister Sarah Jackson, to our vice president, Elder Shockley, to his family, to all of the ministers in the house, to the deacons, saints, and friends, and to our visitors. If you count yourself a visitor, we welcome you and say, may you praise the Lord with all that's within you. He demands our praise. You know, we don't get a choice as to know whether we want to praise God or praise the devil. You're going to praise one or the other. With God, it's voluntary. You don't have to do nothing but just do it. But with Satan, he requires everything you got. And he wants you to work at it day by day. Look at the drug addicts. Look at how bad it is, the drug problem is, how bad it is. People are dying every day. We got more people dying from drugs than we do from car accidents. And that is a shame. But you do things because you want to. Nobody forces you to drink or use drugs. Nobody forces you to stay out there. But the will of God is that all men be saved, that none perish, but that all come to repentance. We thank God for the opportunity to be here today, and still looking for the Lord to touch my body and to deliver me so I can get back to where I was. I want to be the same all the time. I don't want to change from day to day, and this day I can walk and next day I can't. But the will of God is going to be done. Yes. I surrender to that. Yes. I don't complain, because I could be flat on my back. Yes. But the fact that I can get around, I can still drive. I can still see the road. Though sometimes I have my doubt, because my wife says, don't you see that car stopping in front of you? I said, oh yeah, baby, I saw it. We're going to call your attention to the book of Genesis, chapter 2. It's all going to be in the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, and chapter 3, verses 2 through 11. Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, and chapter 3, verses 2 through 11. We ask you to stand to honor the word of God. Chapter 2, beginning with verse 15, and it reads, the Lord took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest eat freely, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Over to chapter 3, verse beginning with verse 2. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above every beast of the field, and upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust thou shalt eat all the days of thy life. We want to use for a subject. You can't hide. God is too wise. Pray with us. Blessed Jesus, we praise and we thank you. We magnify and we lift you up. We thank you for this great and glorious day that you've allowed us to be partakers thereof. You didn't have to do it, Lord Jesus, but you did it because you're a great and merciful God. And you have all power. And you've given us just a bit of it, Lord Jesus, to allow us to live in peace and harmony even with our enemies. That you're able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless. Lord Jesus, we ask you to look at over this congregation today. If there be any sick in the house, touch right now in your mighty holy name. Let your blood cover, Hallelujah. Your spirit reign supreme, and joy engulf this house. If there be any sick, Lord, wherever they may be today, touch them by your power and by your might. Let your angels encamp about them. These and all blessings we ask in the mighty name of Jesus. All the people in the house say, Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You can't hide. God is too wise. From the day that Adam disobeyed, and I said Adam, I didn't say Adam and Eve, because Adam was given the commandment. Blame has been passed. First, Adam hid himself and his wife. Then he blamed the woman for the transgression, who in turn blamed the serpent. What had God said? God had said the tree in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, ye shall not eat. Now, there was another tree in the garden that they could have eaten and lived forever. The tree of life. But they chose that pretty tree. Unfortunately, people choose the wrong things today. We have so many excuses are given for things that happen. For instance, a person that's hooked on drugs, our society decides to help them by calling it a disease. Now, I didn't know a disease was a choice. I didn't choose cancer. I didn't choose sugar diabetes. I didn't choose high blood pressure. See, some of those things are hereditary. People think that you get diabetes because you eat too many sweets. No, sweets just helps it to grow. But you could be born with diabetes. Look at the kids nowadays that are having type 2 diabetes at the age of 5 and 6. With so many things we could do, but God had told them. Look at what God had done. He gave them a perfect environment. Everything was in place. They really didn't have to pull no weeds. Didn't have to worry about the thorns and the thistles. All they had to do was just sit back and cool it. And when they wanted something, there was a tree with a fruit on it. And that's all they had to do. Look at all the trees they had a choice of, yet they were allowed, or they allowed themselves to choose the tree good and evil. Why would I want to be involved in evil? But because of Adam and Eve, we are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And the only remedy for that is the Holy Ghost. But you don't just get the Holy Ghost by going to CVS or Walgreens. You got to first repent of what you have done. And you know everything you did. It's not hidden from God. Don't think you can say, Lord, forgive me for lying, and you were a thief too. Go and tell him the truth. Tell him what you did wrong. He's a forgiver of everything that we do. As a people, we have learned to place the blame on others rather than accept blame. To this day, things remain the same. People are quick to pass responsibility. Don't think God does not see you. You can't hide. The Bible speaks to those that are His. Trying to hide from God brings about disobedience. Saul, when he was picked to become king over Israel, went and hid. And when his whereabouts was asked about, it was told he's hiding in the stuff. The Bible says Saul was head and shoulders above every man, so he stood out. If you stood out and are given a position, why not do it to the fullest? Why not put your all in all into it? Why not give it, turn it over to Jesus? If he called you for a mission in his field, then he's given you the ability to perform that mission. Not, Lord, it's not me, it's Sister So-and-so. She's the one you should use. He didn't call Sister So-and-so, he called you. I don't know a minister that I've ever come in contact with who's voluntarily said, yeah, when he called me, I was ready. Oh, am I missing somebody? Is there one in here? Is there one in here that the Lord called you and you just jumped up and said, yeah, Lord, it's me. Here I am. Pastor, the Lord called me to preach. When are you going to give me my robe? When are you going to give me my first sermon? I'm not going to talk to you because you're dangerous. I'm going to tell you go pray a little while longer. Maybe the Lord has something for you to do that you don't even know what he's talking about. But we've got to be submissive. We've got to learn how to turn it over to Jesus, and he will fix it. He was told to utterly, when Saul was king, he was told to utterly destroy the Amalekites. He failed. When he came back, and remember I told you earlier we talked about how you pass the blame? So what did Saul say when he didn't obey God? It's the people. It's easy to pass the buck. It's easy to blame someone else. But if we just look in the mirror, that person we see is the one to blame for everything that happens in our life. We choose things not out of necessity, but because we want to be recognized. Look how many times people have been killed, and one of their reasons for killing that person was they disrespected me. I learned after 20 years in the Army that respect is earned. You don't demand respect. You get respect because you're doing things right. You're doing things the way you should do them, not the way the world is telling you it ought to be done. The Bible is telling you, what Frank Sinatra had this song, My Way. You can't do it your way. It's either God's way or the devil's way. And whichever one you choose is the one you'll follow. When he didn't destroy the Amalekites, that started his downward trend with God. In the Bible day, the king was the person who went out in front of the troops to fight the battle. They either lived or died in battle. But every time there was a battle, they went out. If you remember when David got in trouble with Bathsheba, they had told him he was too old to go out in the battle, don't go no more. So what did he do? Someplace he shouldn't be. Out there gazing around. Saw this woman bathing. And as a king, he had the authority to do what he wanted to do. So what did he do? He went and had her brought to him, and he committed adultery. So the first thing you want to do is cover up your sin. He went and got the woman's husband, brought him back, said, go on over there and be with your wife. we're going to give you a break from battle. He said, as long as the battle is going on, he said, I will not go home until it's over. So when she became impregnated, and God told Nathan, go talk to him and tell him he had committed sin. And when Nathan got through him, he said, a person like that ought not live. And Nathan the prophet told David, he said, thou art the man. Don't you know that God sees everything that happens in your life? You're not covering up anything that God does not know about. When it was time to go further in battle and Samuel the prophet hadn't showed up like he thought he should or was on time, he went and offered sacrifice. Well, the Bible forbade him to offer sacrifice because that was for the priest. The priests only were the ones that were allowed to offer sacrifices unto God. That's mistake number two. And then when he went and still didn't do things right, and Samuel tried to help him by praying and asking God to bring him back, God can't bring a person back against their will. If Saul wanted to come back, all he had to do was repent. But he didn't repent. He fought against, tried to sneak around and cover things up. You can't hide from God. So when Samuel kept praying for Saul, God told him, he says, Samuel, how long are you going to pray for him, seeing as I have rejected him? You can become so bad that you can be separated from God through eternity. I don't know about you today, but I don't want to be separated from God. I want to be ready if I'm at fault, if I've done something wrong. If I've said something wrong, I want to clear it up with God while I still have breath in my body. We don't know when the day is going to come when he's going to call us out of here. But the Bible tells us to be ye also ready, for in a moment when ye think not, the Son of Man shall appear. Now, you don't have time to get ready after he comes. Because when he comes, it's going to be in a moment. In the twinkling of an eye, if you're not ready, it's going to be too late. You can't hide from God. Jonah tried it by taking a boat to Tarshish. And when he got on that boat, he went down into the bottom of the ship and went to sleep. God told him, he said, Jonah, I know where you are. You're down in the bottom of the boat. I'm going to send a storm here and wake you up, brother. Let me paraphrase a little bit. Let me wake you up, brother. I gave you a mission. You decided that you knew more than I did. You decided who should be saved and who shouldn't. I told you to go into Nineveh and preach to the people and tell them to repent. But instead of you obeying, you decided to try to hide because you didn't like the Gentile nation. But I gave you a mission. Everybody, if you're saved, sanctified, and Holy Ghost filled, you are on a mission from God. And if God gives you a mission, do it with all your might. Don't try to hide and cover it up. David tried to hide his sin with Bathsheba. You know the results. Look at the downfall and captivity of Israel. They were given the Ten Commandments. They were told they were a chosen nation. God made a nation out of a people that were not a nation. And how did they reward him? By resorting to idolatry. By going back to what they came out of. You can't go back to where you come from. If you came out of sin, stay out of sin. If you want to be right, you can be right. The song saying, when I pray at night, I tell the Lord, Lord, I just want to be right. If there's anything in me that's not like you, show me, please. Wash me, purge me, cleanse me. Lord, show me as you see me. I don't want to judge myself in the instance that, oh, I'm all right. It was just a little fumble. No, any wrongdoing, any iniquity. The Bible says from sin and unrighteousness and any such thing. He wants to wash us, purge us, and cleanse us through and through. So that when he gets through with us, we're ready to go back with him. But he can't get us ready to go back with him unless we surrender to him. The Lord knows our mind, our heart, our thoughts, our spirit, our ways, our good, our bad, our attitude, our down-sitting, our uprising, our going out, our coming in. Confess it. Have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about it. He will hear your faintest cry. He will answer by and by. Cheer up. We got angels watching over us. We as saints of God have no excuse for sin, and especially trying to hide it. Don't you know it may not be sin, but it's a such thing. And a such thing is just as bad as sin. When we have people, and we face people every day that don't like us, don't go on Facebook and lambaste them. Go on and pray for them. So I'm offering this prayer up to God that he will change you as he changed me. I don't have a desire to do the things I used to do. Oh, but the devil's going to try to put them in there. He's not going to let you rest peacefully. Everything we go through is allowed by God. But it's not more than we can bear. We got to quit looking at things as somebody don't like me. Somebody got something against me. And no matter what they say, you can't control their speech, but you can your own. Better not say that to me again. Or what if they do? You going to quit being holy? Instead of being a light, you're going to be a lamp that went out? Oh, you got to be right with God in order to go back with him. And the days are not going to change. They're going to get worse and worse. I was telling somebody today that this stuff is going on in Washington, D.C. There was a man put in prison for lying. I said, well, there wouldn't be nobody in the White House if they went to jail for lying. You show me a politician, I'll show you a liar. Arrogance, corrupt, demonic, will do everything but live right. And the first thing they want to do is pass the burden on to somebody else. Jesus came and died to bear all of our burdens. He fixed it so we could serve him in righteousness and in truth. We can serve him in the beauty of holiness. And it doesn't matter what it looks like. God is still in control. And this is just a light testing. We are really not going through things like they went through in the day. Look at the prophets, how they were killed for being honest. Look how they were killed for worshiping. Look how they were killed for telling the truth. The Bible says we got to tell the truth. I hear people say, tell the truth and shame the devil. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Trouble won't last always. It's working for our good. It's designed to mold us and make us after the will of God. It's designed to show us that way that's pleasing unto God. It's designed to show us that we can take this stuff that's coming our way because it's not more than we could bear. It's just a light affliction. It's just a light affliction. Hear what I say, it's just a light affliction. The devil wants you to give up. It's just a light affliction. The devil wants you to give up. It's working for your good. It's designed to show you you as God sees you, because if you don't get rid of that thing, you got an attitude. Had a nerve to walk by me and didn't speak. You don't know what's on anybody's mind. God can read your mind. You can't read nobody else's. You don't know what they're going through. Why didn't you speak? Why didn't you go out of your way to say, praise the Lord? Sometimes people need a little cheering up. I don't know about you, but I need prayer sometimes. I need help sometimes. I ask the Lord. And the Lord works through people. Somebody's going to call you. Somebody's going to say something to you. Or somebody's going to pray for you. You may not know it. But because they came to that person, the Lord sent that name to that person. That person is praying for you. And you might have just walked by them that past Sunday. But God has laid them on your heart. God has laid you on their heart. We got to know what it's going to take to get through this world. You can't fix it, but God can. Don't hold it. Confess it. Let it go. Cheer up. Live in the sunshine. It will all be over after a while. And that's where we ought to be working toward the last time we have to go through this. We don't know the day that the Lord shall return. We don't know what's going to happen on tomorrow. The Lord holds our future in his hand. Get wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up in the Lord through prayer and fasting, through suffering. Sing a song when you feel like things are going down. There may not be nobody there you can talk to, but you can always talk to the Lord. And honey, you can talk to him in a loud voice when you're in your own house. There don't have to be nobody there. But you can talk to the Lord all by yourself. And he promised that he would hear our prayer. The Lord hears and he answers prayer. It don't matter what the world is doing or what the world is saying. What is God doing? He's still in the saving business. He's still in the healing business. He's still in the delivering business. Ask the woman with the issue of blood when she had spent all of her money. Had none left. And she said, she saw the things that the Lord had done. She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I don't need to be anointed with oil. I don't need to sit and hear a sermon. But what I'm going through, I just need a little touch from the Lord. I just need to reach over and touch the hem of his garment. She made up her mind that she wanted to be healed. So she pressed her way through the crowd. And when she got close enough, she reached and touched. The Bible says she was healed at that moment. And Jesus said, somebody touched me. What did his disciples say? How do you know somebody touched you? Because he is God. He knows who reaches out to him. And he's fully able. He can. And he will. He also knew about Judas. When Judas, who was in the crowd, saw the miracle. Was able to feel the presence of God because he was in the midst. And when he decided, I'm tired of this. I need the money. And when that woman took that money, that ointment, anointed the feet of Jesus, and he said, we could have taken that oil, could have taken and sold it for X number of pieces of silver. So what did he do? He devised a plan. And don't tell me that he didn't know what was going on. He saw the power of God in action. He had access to that power. But what did he do? He went to the high priest and said, look here, got a deal for you. For 30 pieces of silver, I'll betray that Jesus to you. The one that I kiss, it's he. And in the communion, what did Jesus tell him? One of you shall betray me. They always started, is it I? Is it I? Jesus turned and says, go do it now. He didn't go give up. He didn't go and repent. He went and got the priest, and they went to where Jesus was because Judas knew he went to the garden to pray. When Jesus had prayed, here comes Judas and his compatriots, those that wanted to destroy Jesus. Saints of God, we got to understand this was a plan from God. That Sunday school lesson title, I believe today, was A Better Plan. That better plan was designed for us. We couldn't save ourselves. We needed a Savior because sin was rampant in the world. And it took a God who was fully able with all power to bring us out of darkness into this marvelous light. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Let Jesus fix it, because nobody else can. Stand to your feet, please. We'd like to know today, is there one? Is there one? Is there one you would like prayer for some reason today? You know why. Come on, ministers. God if you would just one prayer. You're in God's hand. Let him have his way. Let him have his way.